I'd say a person who has gotten a trophy in the past and had a couple miserable years, I could see him wanting it more than anything else in the world. I'm one of them. When I got my first trophy, it felt nice, but we felt like we were a strong team and it was just kind of expected a little bit back into some. But now it's like I've been through so many different like bad rosters, like bad team environments, whatever it might be, and I've basically just been relegated over and over again. So actually coming back here and like trying to win NA, it's a huge motivator for me, and that's like literally why I've been continuing to play. So I would definitely say like someone who hasn't had it for a while, I mean, I really, really want it.
Want to see this series go the distance. I want to see him have the shot at hoisting the trophy. That means winning Game 4 and bringing us to Game 5. Welcome back to the Caster Desk. Of course, we do have Game 4 coming up in a sec. TSM do lead the series 2-1. Zale, what's this game going to look like?
It's hard to say. I mean, I think we're going to find out a lot in pick and ban, right? It's one of those situations where we have had this adaptation coming through, you know, solo off of the Ornn in Game 3. Do TSM change up their strategy whatsoever? Do they look to draft a little bit more towards teamfight? Are they still confident in the TF? Is that even going to be available? Those are some of the major questions that I kind of have coming into this one.
And I mean, you look at the most common champions for Santorin, especially in playoffs, it's Volibear after Volibear after Volibear. I liked when they're playing Santorin on a tank jungler. They actually tend to have decent early CC. Santorin is the first Blood King of the LCS. He's one of the first Blood Kings of the world. When you even look at all the other top leagues, he still is a top performer there. So you get him on a Trundle for a Pillar Q gank. You get him on a Volibear or something like that. It's actually worked out well for him. I thought his Hecarim went really solidly because he could pull the trigger and they could leave solo on something like the Gangplank that he's played so many times before. FlyQuest are not letting up with the Nidalee bans. TSM, seeing that FlyQuest lost all their blue side games, they get side selection with the loss, they say, all right, we'll take red, go back to first picking, go back to giving us counter picks, deal with it here, as they keep the Thresh ban, they keep the Lilia ban, and we'll see what they get third. Probably Shen.
I would expect so. You know, it's been interesting, though, because coming out of yesterday, I was thinking, oh, man, Shen, it's going to be this key pick for TSM. They're going to flex it between jungle and top. And actually, they just ban it every game because they don't want to pick it early, and they know that solo would be willing to pick it blind to try to absorb the pressure and have relevance elsewhere on the map. But I did like that FlyQuest, you know, went strong to one side of the spectrum as far as if you're going to play against a 1-3-1, you either have to draft to match the 1-3-1, or you have to draft to punish the three-man squad when the solos are splitting, right? And they went hard towards punishing the three-man squad with Nautilus plus Hecarim plus Orianna, speed ups, hard engage, point and click CC. That's the style that they were looking to bring out here. It will be Turtle, though, off of Senna, who, you know, I know the analyst S was a big fan of and did honestly help out solo some in that side lane. Having the Senna ultimate to back you up can be pivotal in those types of scenarios. But Caitlyn, obviously an incredibly strong marksman. They're not willing to give that over. So it's just going to be Caitlyn versus Ashe.
Ash set every single time. It's this comp over and over again. TSM get it 4 times in a row at this point. It's just what they want to play. And one thing I want to point out is FlyQuest with the TSM absolutely must have been scrimming for most of last week because FlyQuest sitting alone in the top bracket. They've got either TSM or TL to play against, and they're going to play one of those two over and over again. They must have seen that apparently they couldn't beat the Lucian. I'm looking at TSM's games this split. I don't see any Lucian games here. There's one for Doublelift, and that's it. And maybe he actually clapped bot lane, and they couldn't ever handle it, and that's it. But to put so much pressure on that when no other marksmen are banned seems unlikely. The Nidalee never being left up. The Nidalee Renekton, apparently, they couldn't beat that in scrims. They said, look, we've put in the practice against it. We know we can't do it. We're going to keep that off the table. Go ahead and play Ashe set. Clearly, TSM want this, and FlyQuest are inflexible in their bans because they know what TSM do well with. And that's things that we as viewers can't see, but these teams clearly understand as they're playing the games out. Volibear back in for Santorin, I think, is a great choice here, by the way. Azir is going to be a strong team fight before it gets banned away for Fly and Power of Evil.
So this is the first kind of inflection point. Does Bjergsen just go back to TF and say, yep, back to the side lane, or does he go for a LeBlanc or a Syndra or something a bit more aggressive and try to really go at Power of Evil and punish him? That would kind of signal that they want to look more towards skirmish, that they want to look more towards 5v5, fighting FlyQuest head to head, and that is going to be the change here. I thought there was the opportunity for it, and Bjergsen will lock in that Syndra, his career most played champion. Everyone was talking about the Zillion, but you can't forget about this Syndra. He has been a monster on it for years and years and years. And yes. Now I am really curious, does this mean that TSM is going to fully opt out of that split push? Like, will they still go for the Jax? Will they still look for a Camille? Or are they just going to go towards more of a straight up 5v5 style top laner, something like the Mordekaiser, or something like a tank of their own, and look to really just play for the team fight and try to outplay FlyQuest in that scenario?
Good chance we see something come through like, wow, interesting. They're thinking, hey, you know, set top may still be the case. We saw this in game one as well, by the way, that FlyQuest in the second phase of bans threw a couple jungle bans in case set went up there. They're throwing a couple in. Of course, Santorin, known for his Evelynn, clearly speaking, can play it here as well. They must have seen that. He has played it in the playoffs themselves and would have seen that in scrims there as well. And so, need some couple final bans to come through. Worth pointing out that Gangplank immediately banned away by TSM. I think he's the king of weak side top laners, has the wave clear. You can ult so you don't lose your turret when you get dove, and Mordekaiser off the board as well as FlyQuest try to throw in some support bans on top.
So I think Broken Blade, if you want to go a middle ground, you could still go Jace, and because Jace can play for a pushing top and get an advantage, and then group and still team fight, especially if you're looking for kind of an earlier spike alongside that Syndra. Your mid game with Jace plus the Syndra is going to be really, really strong for that 5v5. So that is an option if they want to kind of go somewhere in between, like hard commit, side lane, and team fight.
And he blinds it. This is very interesting to me that, you know, so much of this game has moved around on how much pressure has been topside and getting a good matchup that you enjoy. Jace is going to be blinded here, thinking that solo might have blinded it, and they thought that a counterpick is worse than getting the blind Jace here instead. Or they really, really care about the support matchup, which is, of course, relevant here as well. Don't get me wrong. Rakan is by far both supports most played based on what's left in the pool. Doesn't mean it's good for the matchups, but it's certainly there for the comfort side. And FlyQuest say, no, we're going to go back for engage. We still like Ignar on a playmaker. And even though the Rakan is up, he says, based on the champions and the board, the fact that Syndra is here for the knockback and whatnot, Pantheon is better for me.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, the thing is, like, when you're going Jace here, you could be going up against the Volibear, which is probably fine. If the Volibear is jungle, it's not the most powerful of ganking junglers. And then, like, what else is in solo's pool that you're really worried about, right? A lot of top laners have already been banned out. Mord's banned, GP's banned, Shen's banned, Lucian is banned, and as a potential, like, really aggressive pick. So they're probably expecting the Ornn anyway. And if you're okay just playing for pressure and playing for push on that Jace, I think it is totally fine to blind that, to say, all right, I'm going to have priority top. We're going to be able to play for dragons. We're going to be able to play for scuttles. We'll have push with the Syndra. We'll have push and priority with that Jace. Set can match up fairly well against that Volibear. And then if you leave your support pick for last and you get a counter in that support 2v2, then you have a winning lane, potentially in three lanes, and you can play heavily for the early dragon stacking. Try to get yourself into a situation similar to they did in game number one, where they are heavily ahead as far as the objectives, as far as the dragons, and then try to force FlyQuest to come to you at that third dragon fight, be ahead in gold, be ahead in power, and dominate there. And on the other side, it's going to be up to FlyQuest to try to withstand that onslaught, to try to utilize some of their really, really strong scaling here, and to avoid the Pantheon attacking this Jace and picking on the Jace, because unlike with the Jax in a side lane, a Jace can definitely die to an Ornn plus Pantheon.
Yeah, gankable certainly in these lanes. You have low escapes outside the Morgana lane overall. That situation that TSM is in is, I am a fan of Santorin and his Volibear. He can get in there and get stuff done. The question is, can he do it here in this crucial game four? TSM are still on match point. FlyQuest must win to keep this finals alive. Otherwise, TSM walk away with their seventh trophy. FlyQuest would certainly love to get there first. It'd be the first as players for most of that roster here as well. So game four is live. We are on to Summoner's Rift. TSM picked red side and said, hey, let us get counter picks in all of these lanes, and they have done so. Pushing lanes across the board, advantage lanes across the board. Question is, can they get it over the finish line afterwards?
Well, to find out, we are into potentially the final game here. FlyQuest obviously would have to continue that reverse sweep. They look so much better in that last game. They do have some good engage options here. They do have those go buttons. But the Pantheon support, you know, I kind of remain unconvinced. And I do think it is a very risky pick to be going back towards. You have to be playing from ahead. You have to be able to push the pace with this pick. Because when you are behind on it, it has no fallback plan. It does damage and it goes in, and that's about it.
Yep. Well, he was 2-1 with it coming into this series all time with a barely KDA above 1, but did win, was an engage. And this is Ignar. I mean, this is the man who was famous for as you hear the story retold eventually, he couldn't really play Ardent Sensor supports back on the very famous Misfits roster where they took SKT to 5 games. And so he brought out Forever Leona as the answer to the Ardent Sensor meta. And it actually worked pretty well. He did great on it. But he has always been an aggressive roaming support kind of player where he's going to get in there. He's going to make the big plays and, you know, set up for the team. And to be fair, Ignar has had a very good split playing champs like this. Thresh, Rakan, Pantheon. That's his wheelhouse here. And yeah, the matchup's going to look pretty bad. Like, this is not going to be a 2-on-2 you're going to enjoy, but he's going to try to get out of that lane and try to attack Bjergsen.
While I agree with you, that has been the playstyle he's been successful with, I will say the differences in fallback between a Thresh and Rakan and the Pantheon is pretty extreme, right? Because Rakan always has the ability to get those multi-man CCs, multi-man knockups. Thresh can play it more defensive, has the ability to peel, you know, utility of the Lantern, the slow of the box. Pantheon is just like, you have a stun and some damage in that, and that's it, right? So when you're behind, you become that loop pinata, and it can become very difficult. You do have incredible potential to roam with the point-and-click CC. That is very strong. But there is kind of a timer on it. You've got to be able to make things happen. You've got to be able to keep getting aggressive. And we saw it come out earlier. Wasn't able to find that effectiveness, so we'll see if he can this time around.
Perfect CS so far from both AD carries as the first push goes over. The fly quest way, a very early ward comes down from TSM. Basically, as the lane starts, they ward to see if Sun Torrent's coming down early on for some kind of really, really early gank. Biofrost should feel fairly comfortable on the Morgana. Worth noting that Doublelift went cleanse despite the Morgana support here. It's once again a matchup where there's not a lot of, you know, surprising crowd control. Again, it's Pantheon jump and that's it. And if Bifrost can Black Shield, the guy can walk away and, you know, dodge Caitlyn traps even if needed. Nice little trade there for Bjergsen. Gets the movement speed up. PoE going for Comet, as you tend to do in ranged matchups, and you know, tries to fight for the one-on-one.
It is really interesting, you know, seeing that cleanse come out again. So obviously he really is showing a lot of respect to the threat of that Pantheon stun. Because that is twice now that he has gone for that summoner against this specific champion. Bjergsen running very low on mana here. Obviously, he is playing for the teleport, but you know, with Power of Evil sitting in a more comfortable position, if he can get that push, if he can reset the wave, he can save his teleport while still getting off of base, and that's going to put him in a pretty darn nice spot.
Nice little bit of extra wards coming through as the early sweeper finds a couple, and the nice pickup there from the bottom scuttle is going to make the bot lane feel safe. We've got a lot of pressure right here as the FlyQuest duo is just hard pushing the 2-on-2 right now. Mid laners trading fights back and forth there as well as Bjergsen takes some damage. PeeWee does the same, and we got ourselves a pause in the future as you have our faces on camera again.
That's true. Hopefully we will be able to get this pause sorted out quickly, hop back in. But until then, we can talk a little bit more about this series, about this sort of matchup. You know, it is one of those things where you do expect Morgana and Ashe to have the push. You know, I do think that they should. But the one caveat is that you have to respect the potential of ganks coming through. You know, Volibear plus that Pantheon, you know, that is a very strong point-and-click stun combo. Yes, you have the Black Shield, but if the Black Shield is forced on cooldown, or if you get a flash stun on one target, you flash on one, you stun the other, these types of plays that you can look for, perhaps they can get punished if they are over-pushing, so they do have to be somewhat careful about that. But up on the top side, you know, we can see that Broken Blade actually did go for the Cull, so I'm kind of curious if he is going to go back towards a more scaling style of play. You know, we haven't seen him go for anything other than just pure lethality, but there are options such as, you know, the slower scaling builds, like going for the tier builds and trying to play more heavily towards the late game in the side lane.
Alrighty, well, still going back into this one, you can see the farm pretty equal up at the top side, although there is more for Broken Blade to farm, so he should be taking a CS lead eventually. Ignar going for the deep ward plays, and actually, I mean, look how low Bjergsen is. He stayed in for so long, but I think they got, hey, bot missing. There's also a ward that would have tracked him moving around, but still, you can see this man has to bleed XP and gold. The ward sees Santorin. And Bjergsen is just not in lane right now. And if PeeWee doesn't push anything, yeah, okay, he's got too many minions. He doesn't push it into the turret. Bjergsen will be able to TP back in. Won't lose too much. Ignar can put a ward down to track Spica, and that means the bot lane can keep playing aggressively. But be careful, because Biofrost is coming. Biofrost is on a ward. What great timing on the Black Shield. Means the bind's going to land. Means decent damage, but be careful. As Set's coming down as well, Ignar has to be respectful. End of the day, there's not going to be any kills coming through. Biofrost low down to 150, but can walk back to lane.
Nicely done by FlyQuest, though, pressuring that mid lane, not losing anything on that bottom side, and even chunking Biofrost out, sending him back to base. And yes, Bjergsen doesn't lose that much, but he still did lose experience and gold off of a couple of minions, including the cannon, which can feel pretty painful in the early stages. That being said, he got towards the tier, so he's going to be comfortable. You know, as far as the mana goes, he can continue holding on in this lane, you know, farming it out, and once you get six, your threat is going to go a lot up. There is the potential then of ganks, you know, really looking to take down Power of Evil. And I'm going to be curious to see if TSM can establish push on that bottom side and start moving towards stacking some of those dragons, as I was kind of expecting that they might look for with this type of draft.
Yeah, mid lane going back and forth right now. Small farm lead to PoE. We are going for the farming build, by the way, on Bjergsen. He's on a power trap. Picked up tier. He picked up exactly zero combat stats and was already getting bullied around in this lane. Power of Evil, first to six. Supports playing for ward control around mid lane, but look at that. The Scryer's Bloom is perfect. Mid lane's pushed. Level six for the Azir, and that means the wards go away, and his dragon is almost certainly a target.
Looks like Flygos will make that first move. You know, we can see the Speaker is up on that top side. Maybe going to try to go for solo. Has been kind of the rinse and repeat strategy here for TSM. But Devilith did get his BFI, and he's back down here on this bottom side. So there is potentially an option to try to force them off a little bit. But with Power of Evil having the shove right now in mid lane, lanes are going a lot better for FlyQuest, honestly, than I expected.
Yeah, I mean, this has been really good stuff. The first recoil coming in means you always get the push on the first wave that comes in right in front. So that was FlyQuest getting the first recoil, being first to lane as Wild Turtle, and that is going to be a Drake going down. So 6:40 into the game as the time ticks on. 6:41, the first Drake goes through. Mount Drake comes in. The stat's going to feel good for Solo and Santorin. We'll wait to see what the next one is. Ocean Drake, and then going to have Cloud or Infernal Soul. As we go back to the laning phases, so far so good for Solo on top side. Is Spellbook Ornn, by the way. We have seen Grasp before in the melee matchups. You don't get to Grasp against Jace, so you go Spellbook for some other kind of power instead. Allows him to ignite for trades or ghost or cleanse away from CC, and that may be useful down the line. I mean, Barrier just makes you pretty much invincible with the amount of armor and MR you're going to have in this game. And Solo just going for the early Sunfire Cape. Doesn't feel like Bramblevest in this game, despite being against a ranged champion.
Yeah, I think he probably wants to make sure he's going to be able to get towards those upgrades pretty early here, complete those items, and they are behind him here.
Dang.
He's in trouble.
Knocked in the turret, does take a turret shot, flashes away, ults for this one as well. Speaking easily, dunk to guarantee it doesn't go through. Burns that cooldown, gets himself the kill. First blood, a flash for Santorin, doesn't find himself that kill just yet. Jumps over to try to fight over the shield. Two more autos, and he can't quite get it across unless PeeWee goes for the dive, and he might want for this one. Comet over the top, damage on a broken blade, mid lane not roaming yet. Bjergsen can't TP, but he can walk. As wave is pushed, PeeWee can go for the combo. A little bit of poke comes down from Volibear, but they aren't going to go for the rest of the dive. They call that Bjergsen is moving, and it means a kill comes through. First blood for Spica with no answer.
And Santorin was just way too low, and now six for double lift. It's just for a trade, though.
Oh, that's going to be maybe Cleanse Force. No, they still feel safe. There's not enough damage despite BF Sword on Ashe. Double lift gets some pretty good damage down, and even to run a soil for a bit more. Turtle's probably going to be forced to recall out of this one. Knew there was no one else coming, right? He saw literally everyone else on the map was topside and said, you don't have the damage, don't worry about it. But with a low health bar, might have to work back for this one.
He might, but I am really impressed, honestly, with how they have been able to keep up on the FlyQuest side with this melee support champion. You know, Pantheon doesn't really offer a lot passively. It is generally just the all-in threat. Yes, you can throw out some Qs and kind of poke away with that, but they are navigating this lane very, very well. Again, here we see it up on this top side. Solo getting knocked back into the tower. You knew he's pretty much dead from this position. And Speaker just holding the ultimate, as you had called out, to deny the possibility of an R2. But then Santorin flashing in, trying to look for this kill. He ults forward over top of Speaker to try to burst him down. Of course, we note TSM was able to disengage and survive there. And it is now TSM going for the Herald again, trying to put Broken Blade in a position potentially where he could get a big lead off of some of these blades.
Oh, you're in trouble, maybe.
Yeah, gonna be okay. Speaker picks this one up, and he's gonna be all right for this one. And it's been interesting watching how the 2-on-2 has played out because, yeah, the Ignar Q spam, as we mentioned the matchup, yeah, he can't CC anyone, but, you know, the Black Shield is magic damage only, and ultimately Pantheon just does physical, and you know, despite not getting a stun, he's been able to fight better, and it has meant sort of a laning lead, the fact that they've had the push, no plates, and hey, the farm lead is with double lift overall, but that's off of Wild Turtle taking another recall, and now if Doublelift does the same, they may well get the first play to the game by pushing down to the bot lane and the poke coming through as the longsword stack up. Ignar not doing Bobby's rush.
In trouble here.
Could have afforded it. Just gets the recall in time. Centaurin nearly catches him out. That should still mean a lot of pressure. That will be the first plate of the game going FlyQuest's way. They may greet for a second as the pickaxe and boots are already in. That's going to be good damage. Blue buff fought over, but Bjergsen is here on a control ward. You're not getting this one, Santorin. Does get the reset. Does get vision. Knows what's going on. But he's going through wards right now. He is on a ward right now. This is going to make it very difficult to do anything as Ignar gets rid of some vision. And honestly, Santorin will not cut this off. Blue is handed off. Bjergsen says, I'm just going to stun you. Get away from me. And PoE hits mid for a couple autos.
even just a little bit of a delay on the reset allows him to get a bit of chip damage. You know, potentially they could have delayed Bjergsen even more, denied some minions, got a little bit of damage down. But likewise, not too worried about that. They have a lot of vision in that bottom side river, so they're the ones, you know, really focused on this dragons. Again, it is TSM just focusing on top lane. Now, I did expect things to be looking a bit different in this game coming into it. Syndra, you know, a lot of early mid-game power. Jace, same thing. I expected, yeah, you know, the Morgana and Ashe mostly to win through having the push, right? Because when you have Volley as well as the Morgana W, you can kind of just W the minions as Morgana, get them low, you know, push forward with Volley, proc the lethal tempo, have the extra attack speed to actually really shove in and try to harass that way. But it feels more like they just don't feel safe to push. And as a result, they are kind of just sitting back, and it's just becoming much more of a farm lane.
Yep. Sightstone's done for both supports. Means time's to recall. Biofrost does that, gets his three wards. Now coming through for Ignar, level 6 coming through. Usually those time up pretty closely. You get level 6 around the same time your Sightstone completes, 11 minutes, roughly, give or take a little. Solo playing defensively, and I gotta point out, look at the minimap in the top left corner of the minimap. Look at the row of control wards. That makes it impossible to do anything at top lane or the top side of mid. Completely owning the top river is TSM, and I mean, this is the most beautiful sight as a top laner. Is Spica in this brush on a control ward. You can't do anything. I'm here, I can do whatever I want. This turret is my plaything. You can't stop me.
The wards are just very clearly dictating the game plan, right? You know, all the pink wards on the bottom side for FlyQuest, all the pink wards on the top side pretty much that are aggressive for TSM. They do have some defensive ones on that bottom side to try to protect their weak side from the dive. They're gonna grab this first turret here straight up, yep. But it is gonna be at the cost of another dragon, right? That is the first two dragons easily taken away here for Santorin. So TSM is going to have to hope that their gold lead will result in a teamfight win in 5 minutes at that Infernal, because that is where they are going to be potentially forced to fight.
Yeah, and this is the benefit of top pressure. Yeah, it's not a ton of kills. Yeah, it's only 14 CS, but you just got about 1,000 gold and change off the turret and the plates and first turret gold falling. You put it onto a Jace. Jace is spiked right away. His Cole, he's at 101 CS. Yomu's Ghostblade is in. Okay, unfortunately, the two Drakes were already taken in time. But for Drake 3, you've got a very powerful Jace who is ahead of the curve. He's probably the richest member of this game right now, ready to start taking over at that 17-minute mark. That's when the next big fight's going to be. You're seeing players fight around this as you've got players going back to their side of the map. Jace is holding mid, Syndra's going topside instead. They want to keep Jace sieging as they move the lanes around to look for more done. Another plate falls in bot lane though. Four plates taken by the Kate Panth duo. Jungle pressure was top, so Santorin got two Drakes and helped make sure the turret took pressure. And now PoE flashed with the ulti back. They're going to catch Broken Blade. The stuns are there. Panth, for good measure, Ignar says, I am helping, and steals 300 gold.
Takes away that kill. They do knock down Broken Blade. Flash coming through from Power Evil. Broken Blade, once he's stunned up, he knows he can't really flash out of there. So he does end up getting picked off. The Pantheon on the board here. Bjergsen does not see anyone in that brush. Going to have to be a little bit careful. His spells are on cooldown.
It's forcing the flash, though. Solo obviously is so tanky, despite stacking armor, is not threatened by no Seraph's level 10 Syndra, and the CC combo is too much. Santorin could have been there. Bjergsen flashed away, and hey, good movements. By the way, bot turret got taken down. May not have gotten the fifth plate, but they still got the gold for that one. Mid lane lost a plate here as well off the fact that Jace couldn't really handle the fact that three people ganked him, and FlyQuest have gotten the game within 600 gold with two Drakes. Feels good.
Yeah, they should be really, really happy about their position, honestly. And when you have the Ornn versus the Jace, when you have the Azir versus the Syndra, you're pretty comfortable with your scaling in both the soul lanes. They should be favored in that regard. I do think that, you know, Caitlyn and Ashe, it's a bit of a wash. Set Volibear is a bit of a wash. And I would probably favor the Morgana over the Pantheon as far as teamfight power. There is potential for that Pantheon to really get a lot done, but kind of the baseline effectiveness is going to be higher for that Enchanter support. But we will see if FlyQuest can really make use of their soul laners and the power that they are going to bring for them going forward.
Okay, Turtle. Richest, actually. Spica and Broken Blade right there, because, of course, they shared in the turret there. Turtle getting a lot of the solo turret gold there instead of the top lane being shared back and forth means you've got a very spiked up Caitlyn. Boots upgrade, Infinity Edge, and the crit cloak, as I see that one appropriately. Gonna feel pretty good as we wait to see what his next move is gonna be. 2 minutes on the Infernal Drake to spawn, waiting for doubles to catch up in items. And this is actually the one game where I really would have liked to see Ruin King. You're against triple melee, and it's heavy frontline at that. Ruin King is more auto-attack DPS, and if there's a game to need auto-attack DPS, it's against triple frontline.
Mm-hmm. Makes a lot of sense. I think maybe just emphasizing the utility there, so we may see Speak getting caught out.
More damage, Black Shield slightly late, not necessarily going to matter. Arrow's going to come in, going to find Pantheon. Bind there as well, big damage. Can he get the shield up? Yes, he can, but Speaker may still go for the punch, may still go for the dunk. A flashbang for Ignar keeps him safe, re-engaged towards the front line as Centaurin's forced to ult away. And it is TSM who are stronger. Ornn is not in this fight and still has no ult, by the way. Still 10 seconds, meaning it's going to be easy enough for TSM to feel comfortable. But at the end of the day, FlyQuest able to get some damage across with the traps and able to take control back. And look at this, no one's here in mid. Solo every 12 seconds spams the camp emote and says, look, I'm up 13 CS, by the way. I'm pushing mid lane turret down. This is going to feel okay for me. I'm Ornn. I'm happy.
Mm-hmm. He's feeling really comfortable in this position in this game. Yes, he's going to be down on gold because of the plays, because of the Rift Herald, but that's kind of where the focus was. And you traded focus. TSM put all their emphasis topside to get the Jace ahead, but what that cost them is putting Doublelift behind. You know, Doublelift, when they showed that gold, was like 13, 1400 gold behind Turtle. And if I'm picking, I'd always rather have the tank that is a little bit behind than the carry that is a little bit behind. So we'll right. see if they can make the most use of this, because Ornn, even down on gold, can be very useful. And Jace just yep. isn't the champion to generally win the game through side lane, especially not if you're going for a purely Vality build. Ornn just right. builds some armor, and you can hold on to a tower no problem.
That's the part of the argument I'm more interested in, is less who's behind and more who is ahead. And it's Speak and Broken Blade, right? Who are yep. second and third in gold. Those are the guys with money. So you have the tankier front line right now. You have, you know, the higher damage split pusher right now. And to your point, that doesn't necessarily mean they're going to win because of that, but that is where their gold is. It's on those. Those are the guys who got the early pressure. Those are the ones who are rewarded from the early shot calling. But FlyQuest, with 15 seconds of the Drake spawns, get mid pressure. They summon the Azir turret. That way is going to require an answer for Bjergsen. At this point, with Bjergsen answering this lane, he will not be in the river in time to fight for the Drake. Now, maybe his team can stall. Maybe Broken Blade's poke will be enough. This is the point we were talking about. This is now the time for Broken Blade's ganks to pay off. This is the time for Jace to show up in the mid game.
I think they've already lost the dragon, to be honest with you. Their positioning is so bad, it's going to be so hard to actually walk through these traps. And if they funnel in here, Ornn's just going to ult. So this is really dicey for TSM, but they're trying to force it.
Oh, nice stun by Bjergsen, stops the Ornn in its tracks, but it is going to be Drake number three grabbed. Arrow comes in, not going to land either. Spica finds the ult, finds a slow, a flash for Turtle. Double stun comes across. Big damage to the frontline. Centaurin's running out of health. The jump in for Broken Blade. Can he get kill number one? Yes. How about the rest of the fight, though? Back into his Biofrost. PoE picks one up. The snipe coming in. Broken Blade at 50 health stays alive. Speak of the same. And it's two kills for the TSM backline. They have managed to get a 3-for-1 team fight by the slimmest of margins. TSM's top end jungle were ahead, and as a result, they stay alive.
I still think that they lose out on this, honestly. I mean, yes, in the short term, TSM gets more because they get a bit of gold, but it's not such a big lead that you really care, because you are at sole point at 18 minutes as FlyQuest. And they have some really strong team fighting, and TSM just did not have the preparation on this fight. You're trying to walk in after the dragon has already started, through Caitlyn traps, with no wards, through this choke where, really, this team fight could have just been an ace for FlyQuest if Bjergsen didn't land the Scatter of the Week to actually prevent the Ornn ultimate from coming through on multiple members. It could have been a disaster for them. Instead, they are able to come out on top just barely, as Spica survives with what has to be single-digit health over on the other side of the fight, and Bjergsen and Doublelift able to get a lot of work done there.
Alrighty, 11 on set, 27 on Jace is the official word from the observers. Thank you for the numbers.
It's more than one.
Yeah. By the way, I have to say it. If Caitlyn didn't go Zeal, Broken Blade was dead to the ultimate. I have to say it because I hate this build, and there is further proof that it would have been a different situation. Yes, move speed matters. I get it. I know there's considerations. Crown Shot does his build. Still hate the build. AD would have killed Jace.
You tell him, freak.
I tell him. Yeah. It's backed up by facts, and most good AD carries do the double BF sword build.
And
we're back on the map, though.
By
yeah? disappointment. It's also backed up by disappointment. And, you know, that's one thing that's been popular about NA this split, has been me disappointed in players. It's the one good saving grace I have, but we're back in the game. Because right now, we have Rift Herald under attack, TSM are grouped up, and right now, they are feeling comfy. They got the last team fight with kills. They did get more gold right now. That gold's worth more than just one Drake, but now the re-engage could be good. Double knockup is there. Fight for the Rift Herald comes across. Speaking of losing a lot of health, he's going to go for the dunk. He's got a shield, and it's not going to be enough. Turtle gets a single kill. Herald was picked up, though, and now the chase in for Bjergsen. Nice double stun, buy some time, but Panth is over the top. He gets the shield, and he takes absolutely zero damage, but he cannot find the stun. So at the end of the day, it is just the kill picked up, and I'm not sure who got the Herald. I didn't see the smite check coming across.
Got it.
It did go to Speak It. Okay. So that probably still comes out TSM favor because you expect to get a turret for a kill as a result.
Mm-hmm. It is pretty close, though, because at yes. the time now, you lose priority on the map. It's what are you going to lose in the meantime? You know, how much can Power of Evil get done up on this top side if there's no one there to respond?
Right now, top lane is getting pushed down, as you mentioned. That's going to mean damage to the turret. Nashua's is done, but PoE is afraid of what the roams might be. Those control wards still paying dividends. The last two got killed. They put two more down. You can still see this entire area of the map is lit up by TSM control wards, which lets them know their jungle's under no threat, and it means that FlyQuest knows they have no vision there at all.
All right, well, this game very likely will come down to this next team fight because I talked about it when TSM had the lead. I got to talk about it when FlyQuest has this lead. Still, no team, you know, that was in the top four and beyond in the LCS playoffs throughout the entire summer split had lost a single game from a 3-0 Dragon lead. You force your opponents to come and fight you every single time where you have this advantage. It really taxes their decision-making. It taxes their ability to set up for the fights. They have to take these fights even if they aren't set up properly for them, just like the last one kind of happened out. So TSM is going to have to make damn sure that they get to that Dragon area soon and start prepping. Because if you try to show up to Soul Point like they did to that last one, it's probably just going to be GG.
Pretty good damage here. Double of dodges the slow. Not going to get speared either. Turtle with the boots upgrade. Moves pretty quick. Knocks down some of the wave. Moves really fast with the Raptor Cannon there as well to give it its credit where due. And we're 1 minute away from the Infernal Drake spawning. That means item spike's got to come in fast. You cannot recall with anything less than 30 seconds on the timer. And even that's cutting it a bit close, which means we're not likely to see Spellbinder out of Bjergsen. We are going to see the boots upgraded out of Doublelift. We may not see the Abyssal Mask in time for Solo. Depends on his individual gold. Control Ward comes in. Items come through. It is time to set up for what will be the Infernal Soul fight. We are 33 seconds away from FlyQuest taking a 400 gold deficit into a very large lead off the fact that they will just do way more damage off the TSM who only has a single frontline. Their burst is going to be awesome. The Caitlyn snipes are going to be big. The last recalls come through, and it's time to put up for the most important objective of this game.
And again, it looks like TSM aren't going to be first towards the pit. It's FlyQuest into the river area first. They're the ones that are getting the inside track and will be able to set up here. So TSM are going to drop the Herald. They did get that last Herald, and this is kind of the benefit of it now. Trying to tax your opponent's resources, trying to force them to respond mid lane to this Herald, and then potentially being able to move into the river with that. Now that Turtle and Power of Evil are back by that tower, they need to go for the engage on the other side, and they're looking.
They find the arrow. The ult from Santorin keeps them safe for now. Ornhorn comes across. What are they going to find with the knockup? It's onto Bjergsen, but it's not going to be the target just yet. CC coming across back and forth. Wave clear to the mid lane. So far, Turret's not going to die. And Wild Turtle going to stack up his overheal shield. As the wave goes down, the control wards go down, and TSM disengage. Ulti's burned on a lot of TSM members, a lot of FlyQuest members here as well. Mostly, though, TSM have theirs. They've got the bigger ticket items available. That makes it harder for FlyQuest, but they don't want to give this one up. Spica on the wings looks at Power of Evil. We know the big play could happen, and we've now got a flank attempt maybe for Ornn or more. Ignar towards the front, Spica the same. Double goes down, a little bit of health, but he's going to be fine. Nice shock blast dodge by Ignar. Mid going to be shoved down. That could be the next play. PoE going to hold on to the passive. I believe he has it right now. Double walks up for some poke. Can't find the stun yet on PoE, but that was nearly the target. Bind not going to land either, but now FlyQuest walking right back in. Still no engage. Ult for the FlyQuest side. Pantheon has his, but that's not an easy target to go for, or an easy ult to use. Still jumping back and forth. Mid lane meets again. This time, though, Caitlyn is going to be unopposed to push this one in, and it means if they want, FlyQuest could take mid-tier 2 as the trade for the Drake that they don't care that much about giving away. Mid's going to crash. It's going to be golden XP that go to FlyQuest that is not earned by TSM, and we keep the standoff. Blue buff graciously on Bjergsen means he has infinite mana and can poke forever. We wait for the ult cooldowns. They are still coming up. Doublelift has arrow back. TSM have 5 ults to 3 for FlyQuest, and that means the fight can begin. The traps come in to segment the front and back line. Dunk comes in, and it's going to be Spica taking a lot of damage. Flash away. Broken Blade comes in, but he's hitting tanks only, and it means we have the reset. We have nearly the snipe, and Turtle flashes in and can't find it. He cannot quite find the kill, but the front line is so low. Spica is going to have a hard time getting back into this fight. Now can they burn it down? Smites are up on both sides. Flashes down for the one side. This should be the attempt, and it's a beautiful steal out of Spica, and a one for one afterwards. Jungler's down on both sides. Is there a re-engage? The question looks like no. Broken Blade TPing back in. Solar running out of health. This could be a TSM fight. Broken Blade is on the way. He's looking for a couple of kills. Ignar slows him down, but it should still be TSM favored. Solo can't find the knockup, but they can find Doublelift. They're gonna find Biofrost, and it's up to the solo lanes now. It's up to the solos against the world. Wild Turtle's low. Solo can try to buy him some time, but Broken Blade is massive. Ignar can try. Can they get the CC combo? That is the hope. They find a slow. He is running. Can they find more? It's time for Bjergsen. Wild Turtle's life-stealing off the wave, and Solo's still waiting around on the wings. Broken Blade can't one-shot anymore, but maybe Bjergsen can. The combo's gonna be a lot of damage. Solo at 1200, Wild Turtle the same. Bjergsen no ult for a while, Snipe's gonna be a lot of damage. Here comes Panther at the top. That should be a kill eventually on a Bjergsen. The minion's doing the work, and the shutdown finally comes through. The Drake was taken, but 4-2 for FlyQuest.
What a crazy set of plays there. The standoff lasting forever as TSM felt like they needed to get a pick before they could start the dragon. They didn't want to have to 50-50 their game on that dragon, so they were trying to get poked. They were trying to look for an angle to start a fight, but FlyQuest was able to get control over mid lane, was never willing to give up control over that dragon, didn't open themselves up to get picked off, and now they are the ones starting up this Baron, trying to force the hand of TSM.
Bjergsen's dead. He's got TP, but he's got to get himself across the map fast right there. One, two ultis, three ultis are missing on the FlyQuest side. They're missing Ornn, they're missing Caitlyn, they're missing Pantheon. 4k health. They've got a Mark Spica. They got to get this guy out of the pit fast. He might store the last one. They're still going for the 50-50, and they get it. He couldn't get over the wall. That was the crucial bit. There was no blast plant, no flash, no chance to steal. 5-on-5 isn't good enough. Solo front lines. Big dunk on a turtle. Can they get the rest? Power people low, shovels them back out. 2-for-1 so far, and FlyQuest sure as hell won a game 5. Bjergsen can try to deny it, but the Ornhorn is here for a single knockup. Biofrost is down, and a 2v5. The TSM solo's again left alone, but FlyQuest got everything they want.
It's smelling like game 5 here, Freak. FlyQuest take the Baron off of a gutsy call. They had the kill on Bjergsen. They knew his spawn timer was very delayed. And TSM make the call there to not go for the smite steal, to instead play for the 5v5, to try to kill off FlyQuest after the Baron went down. That is why Spica is not hex flashing over the wall. That is why they are trying to set up for the angle to corral FlyQuest and take them down afterwards. So potentially they think, all right, can we go for the steal? The call is made that they know they can't. So Spica runs around instead, and they look to try to fight this up. But look at all the damage that is absorbed there by Ignar with a fantastic shield. The ultimate lands from Doublelift, but they cannot follow it up. And the range here on Power Mule plus Turtle was huge. Then look at Santor flashing into the back line. Ults on Doublelift's head, flashes in. W plus the Q, that final auto finishing off Doublelift, even gets out. And then still a lot of health on some of the carries here from FlyQuest allows them to push forward, get full control. They lose no one. They have the Ornn upgrades coming through. They're taking towers. They're taking names. And they are looking to push TSM to game number 5.
And I got to correct what I said at the moment. It was not a 50-50. They knew Spica's flash was down, and you cannot hex flash while in combat. PoE tried his hardest to get a soldier over the wall to auto Spica. He hit him with a soldier and said, this man cannot get over the wall. They do not have smite, and Solo had spellbooked over to his own. So at 1500, they double smite. Santorin and Solo press the button together. No chance to steal that Baron unless you really, really screw up. And it was 100-0. They got the Baron even with TSM in their face. And with those stats, they won the team fight afterwards. And the siege now continues. You've got a 4,400 gold lead. During this Baron buff, they get the setup for the Drake, and then that Infernal Soul spawns.
And I expected TSM to be the ones who are getting so much out of the early game with this type of draft, and I think they did too. You're going for the range support. You're going for the Syndra and the Jace. Power picks in the solo lane. Strong jungler for the matchup. And you know, they really, I think, had to try to push the pace early. They were not able to do it, and now they're in such a tough spot. It's going to take some sort of a miracle for them to really be able to claw it back, but they don't have much playmaking, to be honest with you. You have the Ash Arrow as really your only hard engage, and you know, there's a cleanse on Turtle. Sure, you can try to pray that you get something on Power of Evil, but where's your follow-up? You just have poke. You don't really have a lot of dive, so it's going to be so hard here for TSM unless you can get something onto Power of Evil and Bjergsen can blow him up. I just don't see a way for them to actually win at this dragon.
Well, it's do or die. They're fighting over the wards right now. FlyQuest owning a lot of the vision here. Nice shock blast hits too. That's good damage here. And they're gonna try to contest to play for the bottom lane right now. Now the wave is pushing in. That's an easy turn if they want it, but now the play goes in for this. Now Spica has flash, Spica has smite. Solo doesn't have one himself. So it's a simple smite versus smite. And the play's gonna come across. And again he does it. Plus the dunk onto 4. Is enough from Spica. Shield comes in. Ignar's nearly dead. Into the back lane comes Solo. But the team fight damage may be too much. Bulliver over the top. But look how low PoE and Ignar are. Thankfully Solo can do it all by himself. The front line, the Bash Brothers, Santorin and Solo, put up a couple of S ranks. Samira would be proud as the kills come across and FlyQuest take a fight despite losing the Drake again.
Spica is just saving TSM at these dragons. This game should be all sealed up, but back-to-back smite steals from the rookie, and double team might just be dead.
Yes, he is. He flashes the stun. Turtle has the most flashes in LCS history, and he uses that one to put the nail in the coffin. Doublet is gone yet again. Three dead for TSM. Middle inhibitor is a formality.
That is a man who's looking practiced. That's the power of experience right there, Freak.
All righty. He's got all kinds of records. Most LCS games, only a player to play in every single LCS split. Man is taking over everything that he can right now. And let's see what else we got going on here, because the 7,000 gold leads feels real good as they haven't been able to quite clinch the Infernal Soul, but they've got two more tries.
All right, here it is again. TSM did land some really good poke here on the side, you know, multiple shock blasts hitting the back line. Spica, though, into the pit, down to 379, and he lands that smite. It looked like it was potentially a Caitlyn crit that brought it down from, say, 800 to that 370 mark, and then Spica was able to land that smite, so really well done by him. FlyQuest unable to coordinate their burst on that to secure what would be that soul. They still do win out on the fight, though. We know in that subsequent play, Turtle got the kill on a double. He now has a GA completed, likely working towards maybe even a QSS or just a Hex Drinker to try to erase any sort of chance of him going down whatsoever. But he is so strong. He has the most farm in the game, the most kills in the game. This is a very, very fed Caitlyn. One or two autos from him on Doublelift, Bjergsen, or Broken Blade just decides a fight because he has so much AD. You know, this is a triple BF build here where just that one rapid fire headshot crit on any of those guys, and they basically just have to back it up and say, all right, it's all yours. Sorry, sir.
All right, well, once again, we've got Spica, Flashless, used it for the last steal, which means it's not up for the Baron play, so if you get rid of the Blast Plant and you tag him into combat, he cannot Hex Flash over. And Set, without an ulti target, can't get over with his spells either. So Solo, easy pop of the Blast Plant that betrayed him a little while ago, and now it's time yet again to play for the Baron, and TSM will have a hard time making their way in. They can certainly try, but there are wards down. They can see Spica, they know what he's up to. 7k health, 6k health left on Baron. They're going to take some poke, not too worried though, keeping the team zoned out. Can they put Spica in combat is the question. He jumps in the Fog of War, which means now they can't track that too easily. Doesn't channel this one, Solo gets away despite the bind, and that's going to mean that Baron resets. But the ulti comes across. They go for the engage. They cannot catch Bjergsen though, but Centurion walks in, but he's losing a lot of health, has to ult to stay alive. And that is FlyQuest unable to find the fight they wanted.
Very well handled there by TSM. Staying right on that edge of the engage range. You have to play this dance when you are playing this style of composition where TSM has no true hard engage, no true front line. I mean, yeah, you have the jungle Set, but he's not going to be anything compared to this Ornn over on the other side. They have to be able to keep their opponents interested, land enough poke to try to force them into a situation where they feel they have to hard engage, and then kite it out, focus down whoever is too far ahead on the FlyQuest side, and that's exactly what TSM was able to do. Unfortunately for them, all it nets them is FlyQuest doesn't get Baron. They didn't get any kills. They didn't get the Baron themselves. And with Warmogs over on Solo, he can just intentionally tank up every single bit of poke that TSM has to throw out at him, and he is not bothered at all.
He's a tanky boy. The one that actually, to go back to the earlier point, Rune King would help push through, but not the raw AD build the same way. As FlyQuest are pushing around again for the top side of the jungle. There's still a couple of bastions of safety, though. TSM have the control ward and a couple of invisible ones around this part as well. It is not full darkness. Shock Blast will not quite hit Wild Turtle, level 16 of the Caitlyn. That's big ulti damage that would chunk Biofrost to about half. There's an auto attack, does 313. And here comes the next engage. Stun is not going to catch Doublelift. Great Black Shield from Bio, keeping them alive. But it's again, the mid laner control. Cleanse is going to be forced out. Is there a re-engage just yet? Doublelift going to lose a lot of health here. Is blocked out by the front line. He's going to stay safe. Mid lane going to be cleared, no problem. Hurricane Ash just eats minions for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Dragon Soul spawns in 23 seconds. Baron, we know, is already alive. Spica, can you do the heroic play yet again? Every time Flash comes up as the Drake spawns. He has Flash again just now. We see it here. Can he make it happen again?
But they have no vision at all. It's total darkness for TSM. Sure, you can spot it out with the Hawkshot. Bjergsen's TPing down to them, but they have a very awkward entrance into this fight here. Santorin is already on the side, looking to zone them out. They have no wards in the area. We'll see if they can push their way in.
They got to make it happen. This time around, it finally gets claimed, and Speak is going to kill himself trying to ult in to play for the Heroics. Easy 5v4 teamfight. Devilth is low. The snipe's not up from cooldown, but he has to run away. Infernal Soul is on. No jungler for TSM. Whatever objective they want, they can go for. Pantheon heads bot lane. Looks to catch the wave. Looks to catch Biofrost. The flash is not going to be enough. Here comes Soul over the top as well. Centurion walks up. Two autos will kill Doublelift. They can't quite catch him just yet. He gets in the flag of war, and he gets to stay alive. No knockup for Solo. Snipe doesn't quite get that kill either. And it's going to be the team staying alive just for now. But look at the movements across the map. TSM forced into the base to heal, and it means FlyQuest runs for Baron.
Yeah, they have them all alive. They grab the Soul there. Speaka, no more heroics to be had for him. The entrance was just too damn hard from that position. Trying to walk blind through the whole FlyQuest team to steal that was going to be an incredibly long shot. And now with that Soul, FlyQuest secures a very easy Baron. And you feel like they have everything they need to close this one out. TSM, they're up against it. They're trying to scrape together as many items as they can, trying to find a way to get strong enough so that if they can find a mistake, if they can find an angle, they have the damage to push through and burst someone down. But they are just so far behind. I mean, you compare the AD itemization here. It is a fully completed build for Turtle. Doublelift still has an item and a half to go.
Yep. That's what five kills and a couple of turrets worth of extra gold are going to do for you here. Baron's obviously not a bad amount as well each time you take it down. Centurion walking around to look at Biofrost. Solo wants this one as well, and suddenly this Morgana's got to run away. But he's buying a lot of time. He runs fast. He's got Swifties. And they're going to have two people mark him. They're going to have two go for this play. They're going to find some damage. They're going to find Centurion on the chase down. And they're going to get as many kills as possible. Kill him, then rejoin the team. But it means that TSM have a momentary 4v3.
Yeah, they're going to look for an engage. This is the moment for TSM.
Turtle has no cleanse, he has no cleanse, he has GA, and that's it. They're gonna find him easily, but the re-engage is so much damage. They trade back Doublelift, and Turtle comes back into life. He will still be shut down, and Solo goes too far, but Speak is running out of health as well. They will knock down the turret. It is a one for one. 80 carries die on both sides, but the chase on Biofrost still did work. So this is a 4v3 chase. Solo can recall and TP back in, and the 4v3 can continue. Bottom inhibitor will die. The turret's gone, the inhibit's gonna follow, and mid is an easy target as well. The question is, do they go for the Nexus itself in the 4v3?
I think there's potential to do it. Power Evil has everything available. Stopwatch, Flash, Ultimate, and he is full health. They're gonna look Pantheon. With the Pantheon ult.
They're gonna find the stun up Bjergsen. Will they go for the shuffle? Not just yet. Ignar tanks up for a while, but then has a flash away. Bind won't land. Shield comes in. Be careful, Ignar. Then a 500 HP, but does stay alive. Wave clears pretty easy, and the mid will fall to the rest of the minion wave. So back to double and hip down. Back to TSM stuck inside their base. We are about 3 minutes from both major objectives. 3 on the Elder Dragon and 4 on the Baron respawn, as there's 1 minute left on the Red Bull Baron.
At the very least, they did hold on against that Red Bull Baron. Only a 700 Baron buff power play there, so not a lot of extra gold going the way of FlyQuest. And yes, FlyQuest have really all the cards in their hand. They have the ability to close out this game, but when the items are all complete, your opponents are slowly clawing their way back, are slowly closing that gap. So they want to try to end the game here. Bjergsen is pushing out pretty far on that side lane, and he was spotted. So Bjergsen potentially could get caught, and so could Doublelift.
Is Doublelift the target? Solo has ulti, and they're going to go for the play right now. They will not find the slow, but they will find the knockup. They will find infinite damage, and he cleared waves way too far up. Broken Blade has Black Shield. He will stay alive, but there is now a target on Speaker's back. He gets the health bar down to half, has the shield if he needs it. Ult comes across, turns off one of the turrets, and it's time for the FlyQuest Siege with no Ash to defend for a full 35 seconds. Turret 1 will fall, turret 2 is going to be right afterwards, and FlyQuest will bring us to game 5. Despite TSM's best efforts, the heroic smite steals from Speaker. FlyQuest are one game away from their first LCS championship.
Not to mention a reverse sweep after TSM came out swinging in this series, dominant in the first two games. Everyone's calling the 3-0 except for FlyQuest. They are battling back, looking strong in these last two games, finding ways to create advantages to out-teamfight TSM. And TSM is just not being able to get the same edges, to be able to take over in the side lanes in the same ways that they were in those first two games. They have gone back to the Jace a couple of times here. It just cannot, dominate in the side lane in the same way that a Jax that is way ahead, that a Camille that is way ahead can. And it's making it a lot more difficult, you know, for them to actually figure out how they want to play it. You know, they had a very clearly defined style. I think FlyQuest has a very clearly defined style of the team fight, of the 5v5. And when we see TSM kind of opting into that, trying to have to be the one that, you know, is called on their bluff and trying to match their opponents, it becomes very, very difficult for them to live up to that.
Yeah, I mean, champ select is not everything, but when Broken Blade had a split pusher that could actually build his own advantage and just crush the 1v1 and keep going side lane, the games looked a lot different. When he's on the Jace, you're not really going to do that much more, and you've just got to join the 5v5, and that is where FlyQuest outplayed, especially when Centauran started playing more around bottom side to start the Drake stack. So FlyQuest have brought it back. We will see if TSM have any adaptations left in the tank, or if it will be the reverse sweep. We'll see what's going to be. We are stepping away, but after the break, we are here going to hear from the State Farm Analyst Desk.
Do you hear that, ladies and gentlemen? Do you hear that? That's the sound of silver scraping, my friends, because we're going to a game five to decide who will be the champions of our 2020 LCS Summer Split. I am amazed that FlyQuest, through everything that has happened today, through the first two games not going their way, that they have recovered and pushed us to a fifth and final game here, gents.
I am more amazed.
That, yes. I agree with all the excitement. I didn't hear what either of you said, so I'm going to Crumbs first.
I am more amazed that Twisted Fate was not picked up by TSM here. You just were doing so well with this. This is a strategy that everyone knows you're playing. And it just...
It honestly felt like he got bored or something, because they still picked a top lane carry. They still picked Jace to try and have a top lane bully matchup, but Broken Blade by himself isn't able to, you know, be a big difference when they opt into these team fights. So if you don't have the Twisted Fate, then you have to switch up that side of the pick ban as well and pick a different champion for Broken Blade if you want the Syndra. But as Crumbs is saying, I still think the Twisted Fate and playing that style is a valid attempt. Go ahead, Mark.
All right, now you go, Mark. Yeah.
Bjergsen had a great game 3 on TF and they lost, and he was probably like, damn it, I need a champ that can carry harder on its own. And so he goes for the Syndra. Like, I can't imagine why else you wouldn't just take it into the Azir, the matchup that you played in game 1, I think it was. And then from then on, I also love saving counterpick for solo so he can actually see what's going on. This is what I've been asking them to do on blue side previously, was move your support and top laner into your last two picks so you get to counterpick at least some of this. And Ignar's blind Pantheon actually worked out quite well. The Morgana counterpick didn't really seem to do that much.
Yeah, the Pantheon definitely came up in a big way as a pick when it came to those late game team fights and just wasting cooldowns out of TSM. But let's work our way through this game, because it wasn't, again, all FlyQuest favored through the early game. We were sitting in another situation where it was feeling like, hey, maybe TSM's done all the work they need to do in the early game with a gold lead to take, but FlyQuest around the Drakes.
As long as the games are slow, FlyQuest is in their element here, being able to take these dragon fights. And now watch where TSM is engaging, because they're all just running into the backline, but it's still really, really close because the items that the FlyQuest carries are not yet there. This is only like level 10 team fight.
And to be honest, like, FlyQuest played this pretty horribly. And you see how hard it is for TSM. The fact that it's still almost close, you know, they do win this 3-0 technically in TSM's favor. There was double-digit members on TSM's health are on their side.
And the stuff that's not shown in just that replay of the team fight is the map state and all the setup for this. That was them getting third dragon first. Even though FlyQuest gave over more money, they gave over extra kills, they stacked up those dragons so quickly, forcing the soul point. So then Spica had to come up with these miraculous steals over and over to try and delay the game. But if you're in that point, you're getting forced into the 5-on-5 versus the team that has double tanks with Azir, Caitlyn backline, which is the FlyQuest bread and butter team fight composition. Why in the beginning, when we had the strategies up with the champions, TSM have to make that choice. Are we going to go with the spread pressure, pick Twisted Fate, try and have high pressure lanes, or do they want to go with an easier to execute team comp? Everybody's just kind of wiping it off the table, like, okay, there's no way that you guys go team fight comp versus FlyQuest, right? That's what they do. It is a viable option. Like, these players can pull that off as well. You just have to choose one of the two directions and then play that way.
Yeah, without a doubt. Mark, you called out two of those low health bars on the side of TSM. Set had 11 HP at his lowest point. Jace had 27 to 38 health between the two of them. We're rolling forward, though, to a couple more of the fights, because this series extended in a very strange way.
Yeah, pretty much off the back of those Set Drake steals, like you were hearing him, Kobe, talk about. And it was a crazy game. There were people, you know, not resetting or wanting to keep fighting, even though someone on their team is TPing back to reset. You know, like, there was not super clean coordination.
You gotta be kidding me. Gets another one.
Yeah, and then this just kept going on as people teleport back in. Finally, Broken Blade showing back up, going for the flank. But he kind of gets interrupted by Ignar. There's this jump into the pit. And it just keeps going. People just keep chasing each other.
I mean, that Pantheon just absorbed all of Jace's damage.
It's a level 9 Pantheon. Hello? That's a level 13 Jace. And Ignar's like, you are not entering this team fight. Back off.
Yeah, he TP'd
for
that.
They're actually able to scatter them.
What the heck, man?
I mean, this is why people were critical of the Jace pick, was that it wasn't able to do anything in team fight situations. And I think that speaks to the split push disappearing without Bjerg on that TF pick.
Yeah, from there, while they did lose the dragon, FlyQuest rather gets position around the Baron.
Yeah, the length of this replay shows the state of this game and the craziness that went on. TSM were scrambling the whole time because they don't have the tools to win the straight up, you know, front to back. And then here, Ignar actually blocks a bunch again. And even though TSM get the stun and initiation into the pit, the counter was so good. Santorin actually finding that kill onto Doublelift turned it back.
And look at how much he gets out. And this is why I love Santorin as like a playmaking initiator, is he knows how to dive into four people, kill the enemy 80 carry, and get out as a frontliner. And that's why he's I think, unparalleled in the jungle position, though Spica was able to get the better of him a couple times in this game.
Yeah, fantastic awareness out of Santorin. Love to have that ability. I personally would love that ability. Jump into four people, kill one, get out. I don't know if that's possible for me in League of Legends. And then true to Wild Turtle's personality and persona that he's built all year or all career long, a flash forward for good measure here against his ADC opponent.
Not just a flash forward, but with a dodge of Bjergsen Syndra as well. Very impressive stuff out of him. And he has been getting the best of Doublelift the past two games. So the first two, it was clear that Doublelift and Bio were having a better laning phase and better team fight. But this time, I mean, how do we even track that?
He's got the most flashes all time in the LCS. It's because of plays like
carries.
That.
Of 80 carries.
Of 80 carries, excuse me.
Yeah. Honestly, that was the play of the game to me. That was my favorite play of the entire game. Boom, headshot, gets him down. And it really put the nail in the coffin there as FlyQuest opened up the base.
You got to get inside his head a little bit heading into the last game. You already won after you got the secure on the Barons and the Drakes. You just got to make sure you get some kills too.
I mean, I got to imagine TSM's a little off kilter right now. They were up 2-0 in the series. They weren't the ones who had the technical hook, hiccup that forced the pause and that whole breakdown in play. And they're even the ones who came out better in that game when the breakdown happened. And so for this reverse sweep to be well underway, only one game left, I think there has to be some critical eyes turned towards TSM as they elect to hop back to blue side for our fifth and final game.
Ooh, maybe Caitlyn is a priority that they might be thinking about. I think the set is cool, but I want to see what Spica can do. He had been such a phenomenal carry. What can happen if he's not playing this champion that he's four games in a row on?
Yeah, I think that's River Shen. I think it's, forcing the Caitlyn ban picked up by FlyQuest. I think they're hoping that they don't have to even think about Caitlyn, and then they can maybe first pick the Senna or something away and get the Senna-Ashe matchup, which Doublelift had a fantastic Senna yesterday. We need to see it again here.
Any thoughts from you, Kobe, on how TSM or FlyQuest, either or, could lock this one up from blue and red side?
Our best of five series, especially when you have a long pause like that, always come down to testing the fortitude and the longevity of these players. And TSM actually have so many veterans on that squad that should be able to rally. Spica, of course, is the youngest one, the kind of odd one out that they are going to have to kind of help in that situation. And him coming from the jungle is going to be a really important part for them if they want to take this series. But FlyQuest are the ones riding momentum. They had their lows at the beginning of this series, which was a long time ago. So they're actually the ones riding momentum into this game five.
Yeah, FlyQuest is well outside their valley and on their way towards a peak for TSM, trying to claw their way out of one themselves. Now, Zillion's been on the ban table all series long after that first play. The question is, will it be unlocked here in game number five? With game five coming up after the break, Power of Evil, he's going to share with us what it would mean to win his first LCS title.
It would be definitely like a dream come true. Obviously, as a pro player, as a League of Legends player, you kind of always try to like reach for that trophy. You always try to like reach Worlds, and I obviously managed to get to Worlds before, but I've never managed to get that trophy. And I got so close so many times. I lost, I think, 2 finals, 2-3, which is like obviously really disappointing and really brutal. Like sitting there in the stadium normally, and then like getting the confetti in your face is obviously like a really savage moment, but I'm someone who never gives up. I'm someone who always tries again, and I definitely have the chance again now, and I'm going to give it all to make it with this team.